Hello everyone, I hope you are doing well. Before going any further, I'd like to remind you that next week will be our monthly Q&A section. If you have any questions, please post them in the comments section area and or send me an email if you prefer to be anonymous. Last week, we talked about Li Shen Zhong Zheng, a Confucian philosophical term used for expressing self-cultivation, later adapted by the martial art community to describe the correct practice of body structures in martial training. Like I have mentioned before, many martial art terms are based on ancient philosophical concepts. It is a great phenomenon that old terms have been attributed similar yet totally new meanings in different fields. On the other hand, that has also led to unexpected consequences. For example, literal translation or interpretation of those terms can often mislead the audience. The term Li Shen Zhong Zheng actually is a perfect example of this issue. Unfortunately, due to the development and evolution of the Chinese language over time, many people today most likely misunderstand these concepts, even if it's their first language, unless they have received proper training. If we perceive Chinese martial art training as not only a technical system, but also an element of Chinese culture, then in order to understand it, other direct and indirect cultural elements are very useful, if not essential, to correctly understand them. Unfortunately, due to the changing social and economic conditions in China, it is becoming increasingly challenging for most people to correctly understand ancient linguistic and philosophical terms, even though everyone over there speaks the Chinese language natively. Outside of China, it is even more challenging to improve this situation, even though people understand that introducing the historical and the cultural background of a term or concept can be a key factor in fully understanding a foreign term. That is one of the motivations for me to introduce the internal styles in a systematic way by explaining the original meaning of each term and its evolution. In today's video, I'd like to introduce Shou Zhong Yong Zhong, another popular term used in the internal martial art community, especially in the Xingyi community. This term has been gaining popularity for the last couple of decades already. Shou Zhong Yong Zhong, just like last week's term Li Shen Zhong Zheng, originated in Chinese philosophy, was co-opted by Xiu Dao practice, and eventually also by the martial art community. During this process, the meaning of Shou Zhong Yong Zhong has changed with the type of practice. So, topics covered in today's video include: first, origin of Shou Zhong Yong Zhong; second, Shou Zhong Yong Zhong in Xiu Dao; third, Shou Zhong Yong Zhong in martial art; fourth, application of Shou Zhong Yong Zhong; fifth, key principles of Shou Zhong Yong Zhong; sixth, demonstration; seventh, correction of students' practice; and eighth, takeaways. So, without any further ado, let's get started. Topic 1. Origin of Shou Zhong Yong Zhong. In last week's video on Li Shen Zhong Zheng, I briefly talked about an interesting characteristic of Chinese philosophy. Practical reasoning is the main theme in ancient Chinese philosophy, especially in Confucianism, since all of the philosophical thinking will eventually be applied to ethical practice. In Confucianism, ethics is one of the key concepts. Confucianism emphasizes the integration of knowledge and universal principles. So, in Confucianism, Zhong or Middle is the key principle. There are plenty of terms used to express the similar concept utilizing the Zhong or Middle examples, including but not limited to Zhongyong or constant mean, Zhongdao or middle path, Zhonghe or middle harmony, Zhongzheng or middle way and justice, Zhizhong or the middle position. More importantly, Confucianism specifically emphasizes the concept of Yongzhong as one of the highest moral standards, which means seeking moderation in decision-making. So, in Confucianism, please pay attention to the term Yongzhong. Now, how about Taoism? Taoism, as one of the important ancient Chinese philosophical systems, emphasizes on the concept of Zhong as well. For example, in Dao De Jing, Lao Tzu said, "Duo yan shu qiong, bu ru shou zhong." Or taking non-action as a guiding principle in managing our daily life. So, shou zhong can be translated as following the natural way or calming down the mind, and so on. In Taoism, please pay attention to shou zhong. In Chinese philosophy, the term shou zhong and yong zhong have existed and continue to exist separately. However, in martial art and in some school of xiu dao, these two terms have come to be used in conjunction, giving rise to the joint term shou zhong yong zhong. Now, we can see that the term shou zhong yong zhong is the term that owns its origin to both Taoism and Confucianism. Taoism emphasizes shou zhong and Confucianism emphasizes yong zhong. So, this term shou zhong yong zhong used both Taoism and Confucianism to express a philosophical concept, which is used in self-cultivation through Chinese history by generations. Zhong is the central principle of the term as well. Then, does Zhong remain limited as a philosophical term? That brings us to the next topic. Topic 2. Shou Zhong Yong Zhong in Xiu Dao. Both Taoism and Confucianism rely on meditation as a practical method toward self-cultivation. Especially Taoist meditation or Xiu Dao is the most well-developed system for the refinement of energy and spirit and has been developing for over 2,000 years. I regularly post Xiu Dao videos and I recommend you check out my Xiu Dao playlist if you haven't already. Link is in the description. I'm sure you will find a lot of interesting information about Xiu Dao. So, in Xiu Dao, Zhong means the center of energy inside or outside the body depending on different styles and different approaches in practice. The objective of Shou Zhong, or focusing on the middle area, and Yong Zhong, or practicing and applying the middle area, is to refine energy, or achieve immortality. By the way, the meaning of immortality can be found in my prior Xiu Dao videos. This video focuses on Shou Zhong Yong Zhong applied in martial art practice. So, I will explain Xiu Dao specific practice in future videos. To summarize, Shou Zhong Yong Zhong originated in ancient Chinese philosophy and was later co-opted by Xiu Dao practice since Xiu Dao was and still is rooted in Chinese philosophy. Again, it reflects the fundamental Chinese philosophical concept about self-cultivation. The Taoist practice of Xiu Dao and the Confucian practice of meditation are two of the most important and practical solutions for self-cultivation. A philosophical term was co-opted into internal energy practice. So, how about Shou Zhong Yong Zhong in martial art practice? That brings us to the next topic. Topic 3. Shou Zhong Yong Zhong in martial art practice. So, what about Zhong mean in the context of martial art practice? Well, Zhong has at least two meanings here. One is the body. Body is called Zhong in martial art practice. The other meaning is the central line of the body, which is the better explanation of the term Zhong in a martial context. I have to say that the concept of Zhong is fundamental to not only the internal styles but also all other Chinese styles of martial arts, possibly using different terminology. Understanding the concept of Zhong is useful in improving martial practice, no matter what style. Practicing a specific technique may involve subconscious application of a certain concept, but it does not discount the importance of conscious understanding of said concept. On the contrary, conscious focus and modification of practice based on theoretical concept is an effective and efficient way to practice any technical system, including martial art. Xing Yi, as one of the three internal martial arts, emphasizes Zhong the most in practice. However, my research so far indicates that Wang Xiangzhai, the creator of Yiquan, was the first person to document Zhong in the context of martial practice. Some people claim that Wang Xiangzhai's teaching manual talking about Zhong were written by his students, not Wang Xiangzhai himself. Regardless, what's important is that Wang Xiangzhai's school was the first to recognize and document Zhong in the context of martial art practice. Unless we can find any document older than those written by Wang Xiangzhai, we have to agree that Wang Xiangzhai or his school contributed the adaptation of Zhong, a philosophical term, into martial practice. So, what is Zhong according to Wang Xiangzhai? The central line of the body is the Zhong in martial practice. Shou Zhong consists of two characters. Shou means protect, Zhong means center line. Put together, Shou Zhong means protect the center line of the body. Yong Zhong consists of two characters. Yong means apply or attack. Zhong means the center line of the opponent's body. Put together, Yong Zhong means that in a combat situation, one of the strategies is to attack your opponent's center line for maximum effect. To summarize, a philosophical term was adapted to express the importance of the center line of the body in martial art practice. Shou Zhong implies protecting one's own Zhong, and Yong Zhong implies attacking the opponent's Zhong. Shou Zhong Yong Zhong is a very popular term nowadays in the Chinese martial art community. Topic 4. Application of Shou Zhong Yong Zhong. In the previous section, I introduced Shou Zhong Yong Zhong in a martial context. To help you have a better understanding, I'd like to elaborate Shou Zhong Yong Zhong based on the three internal styles of martial art separately, since even though all of the three internal styles use the same practical approach, especially in combat situations, they are still different from each other. In Xing Yi, Zhong is much an important concept that you can see it everywhere in traditional training manuals. Terms such as Zhong Men or Middle Gate, 中节 or middle section are just two examples out of many. You may have noticed in advanced Xing Yi demonstrations that the practitioner's movements appear akin to attacking the opponent's central line with a spear. When the opponent attacks the practitioner, very often the first response is to protect the central line while deviating the opponent's attack with spear-like movements, a kind of movement using spiral motion aiming at the central line of the opponent. Furthermore, most Xing Yi movements are directed along the center line of the body in different directions, including upward, downward, forward, and so on, such as those demonstrations by the five elements. They are just different variations of Shou Zhong and Yong Zhong in Xing Yi. In Tai Chi, the application of Shou Zhong Yong Zhong is different from Xing Yi. For example, very often, Shou Zhong or defense in Tai Chi applies Lui energy based technique, which is quite a different approach compared to Xing Yi. For Yong Zhong or attack, Peng energy is the favorable technique. Of course, a Tai Chi practitioner can apply any of the eight energies or eight gate energy in a combat situation, and each of the eight gate energy can be used for both Shou Zhong and Yong Zhong. In Ba Gua, Shou Zhong and Yong Zhong are different from Xing Yi and Tai Chi. For example, a typical Shou Zhong or defensive movement in Ba Gua will move the center line away from the opponent attack by applying Ba Gua stepping, while Yong Zhong or attack will apply techniques aiming to attack the center line of the opponent in different angles. Ba Gua is a style that applies Shou Zhong and Yong Zhong much more dynamically than Xing Yi or Tai Chi. Again, it is worth noting that the application of Shou Zhong Yong Zhong in each style varies in accordance with the characteristics of each style. As a practitioner, maintaining a style's characteristics is important according to the traditional standards. To summarize, Shou Zhong Yong Zhong can be applied differently in each internal style depending on its key characteristics. But the primary objective of applying Shou Zhong Yong Zhong remains the same. Shou Zhong implies protecting your own center line, while Yong Zhong implies attacking the opponent's center line. So, are there any guiding principles for Shou Zhong Yong Zhong in martial art practice? That brings us to the next topic. Topic 5. Key principles of Shou Zhong Yong Zhong. I'd like to introduce 3 principles of Shou Zhong Yong Zhong so that you can apply them in your practice. These principles need to be applied in practice through working on some specific movements. Those movements are beyond the scope of this video, and I will introduce some of them in the future. So, the 3 principles are, first, Shou Yong Yi Ti, or Shou and Yong are integrated as one. Second, Lian Xian Zhong Xin, or connect the power to the center line. 3. Xie Chu Zheng Ru, or evade sideways and attack straight. Let me explain each of them. First, Shou Yong Yi Ti. I coined this term about 5 years ago. In theory, we can differentiate between Shou and Yong. However, in practice, especially at a higher level, Shou and Yong should be unified as one. For example, when an opponent attacks you, an advanced Xing Yi practitioner may apply Yong or attack the opponent's center line at a Shou or a defensive movement. In Tai Chi, when you apply a pulling motion, which is a typical considered Shou, but an extended pulling motion can be considered Yong or applying the pulling motion to unbalance the opponent's center line. 首用议题 should be considered in a more dynamic situation in analyzing whether it is the defensive or an offensive movement. In other words, again, my own coinage, 首是用之见，用是首之慎。Translation, 首 is the beginning of 用，用 is the extension of 首。Second, 连线中心。This is an advanced topic in and of itself. I coined this term to express a key practice in martial arts training. When you attack someone's center line, is it necessary to physically reach their center line? Most of the time, it is just impossible because the opponent will either avoid the attack by blocking or retreating. So, an advanced practitioner can instead release power aimed at the center line of the opponent through physical contact with other areas of the opponent's body, such as the arms, instead of the center line itself. Think about it. The power released by you can travel through the opponent's body part, such as the arms or shoulders, and eventually reach their center line. This path between you and the opponent's center line is indirect, but can be traversed through the opponent's body structure. This is an advanced practice, and it takes a lot of time and effort. Please give it a try. Third, 斜出正入. This is a Bagua term, and I use it here to express 手中用中 in the context of Bagua. Of course, it can be applied in 形意 and Tai Chi as well. To evade an attack to the center line,One solution is to move backward or sideways. This is called 斜出. On the other hand, 正入 implies the opponent's center line should be attacked directly. There are many other guiding principles, but these three should be sufficient to get you started. Now, let's look at the relevant demonstration in the next topic. Topic 6.Demonstrations. Today, I'd like to demonstrate an exercise of the 形意 horse form. Hello, I'd like to demonstrate 形意 horse movement. This version is modified by myself based on what we studied before from different teachers. So you may see that's a little bit different from others. So let's start from the beginning form.Topic 7, correction of a student's practice. Hello, I'd like to ask my student to demonstrate one of the Cheng style big palm. The name is Mo Shen Zhang. Then I correct his movement. Now, please. Slowly. Extend. Look out. Yes, then continue.Then low posture, extend, pulling motion. Then go back to the center. Okay, thank you. So now let me correct his movement. Let's do it from beginning. Slowly. So first of all, the finger point to the elbow place. Second, relax the back here. Then one, no problem. Then at this moment,Then rotate both palms because palm coming, then block, then pulling. Then do not stop at here, like two, then body keep turning. Yeah, keep turning. Then continue. Two, three, okay, a little bit more. Like come, you check, look at the movement. So one, two, three, then extend the chest, four.Then five, close, then six, again, One, turn the both palm, extend the chest, then extend. Then continue, next movement. Next, be careful here. Both palm move at the same time. Right palm push downward, left palm extend upward. Right, then continue. Move back toward the center in the end. So up to here, one, move toward center, then three. Slowly, right, then extend, one, then two, then continue, three, yes, then back to the center, thank you. Topic 8, takeaways. First, 手中、用中 consists of two separate terms. 手中 originated in Taoist, while 用中 originated in Confucianism. In a philosophical context, 手中 translates to following the natural way, while 用中 translates to seeking moderation in decision making. Second, 手中、用中 was later adapted in Xiudao practice to mean practicing and applying the middle area with the objective of refinement of energy. Third, 手中用中 in the context of martial arts was first documented by Wang Xiangzhai. In a martial context, 手中用中 means protect your own center line, attack the opponent's center line. Fourth, all the three internal styles apply 手中用中 in one form or another, with Bagua using it in the most dynamic manner. The objective, however, remains the same in each style. Protect your own center line, attack the opponent's center line. Fifth, 手中用中 has many guiding principles, three of which are, first, 手用一体, or 手 and 用 are unified as one. Second, 连线中心, or connect power to the center line. Third, 斜出正入, or evade sideways and attack straight. Sixth, make sure to check out the demonstration and the student practice correction sections to get a better idea of 手中用中 in martial art practice. That brings us to the end of today's video. Quick reminder to sending me your questions in the comments or by email. Thank you for watching. See you next time and enjoy your practice.